skate park design, there is no school. I learned a lot of it through being a skateboarder and attending a lot of skateboard parks and really just having a passion for it and starting to pay attention to what made skate parks work and what made other skate parks not work. So a lot of the job is really fun. A key aspect of this is that my dad is an architect, and without him, there's no way I could have done this. He taught me the basic steps of how to use AutoCAD, and he taught me all kinds of things. So this is AutoCAD that I'm working on. It's a fantastic tool. I'm a classic kid of the modern generation where I can't draft by hand. I only know how to do drafting on a computer, much to my dad's chagrin, but that's how it is. What we're looking at now is a site plan. And these are all contour lines showing elevations of the park. So each line represents an increase in height. So this, all these lines in a row mean that we're going up a hill. So I had to design a park that was going to fit onto the hill. So I've got everything organized into different folders. This folder is all the site information. So we have a geotechnical report in here, which is a study of the soils that are underneath the park. And I can actually show you some 3D renderings of this skate park. This long section of the skate park is currently being 3D modeled, so it'll be right there. And then this is the part of the park that's going to be dug into the hillside. This is another view of the ramp. There are two forms of contract. One of them is a design-only contract. And so some cities only want to hire us for design because they're concerned that if they hire us for the design and the build, they're not going to get a fair build price. Other cities recognize that skate parks are really challenging to build and a real niche, and they understand that they want a skate park company who specializes in these to build them. Okay, so what I'm doing here is calculating how much material is going to be inside the skateboard park. We need to know how much concrete, how much rebar, how much lumber, and all these things so that we can price it and give the client a price to build it. Wow, I've learned so much. I mean, I knew just about nothing starting into this. You know, I knew what worked for skateboarding, but I didn't know anything about concrete mixed designs and how thick concrete has to be and how you reinforce it with what type of rebar and how you change the concrete type based on what the soil profile is. So I've learned a ton about engineering. I work with an engineering firm called All North, mostly in downtown Vancouver.
The bottom part of the joint can be a silicone base.
Oh, cool.
And great. The top part can be just a regular grout.
Nice, okay. For me to learn in the context of something that I love, it's just, it's all stuck. I've learned this information and it's with me for the rest of my life. So we're on our way to Pemberton. The main reason today is to go check out the opening of the Pemberton Skatepark and check a few of my other parks along the way. That's something I do anytime I'm passing through a community where we've done one of our parks. It's always helpful and interesting to go back and just see how the park is holding up. With respect to traveling, I have a bunch of partners all over the country, some architects, landscape architects, engineers, and some skateboarders who do those inspections for me so I don't have to travel all across the whole country and burn all that fuel. We also have parks in France and England, so I have the same over there. Yeah, we're just coming into the heart of Whistler Village. So I got started in skate parks because I was living in Whistler at the time, and the old skate park, which is right around the corner from us, was literally so cracked up and broken that we couldn't even ride it. So we approached the municipality and said we want a skate park, and they said, okay, sure, sounds good. What's a skate park? You better draw that. I got really involved and worked hard on it, and all of a sudden they gave me a job and said, you're construction manager. And I was like, what's construction manager? I'm a dishwasher. What are you talking about? And they said, no problem, you can do it. So it was just kind of trial by fire and learning and getting started. And that park was so successful that the phone started ringing off the hook, and other people said, can you do a skate park for us? And I said, I guess so. And eventually I got fired from my dishwashing job because I was traveling around doing too many skate parks.
In the beginning, when I first started this business, sales was everything, and sales was pretty brutal to convince a community that they were going to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on those dirtbag skateboarders was really tough. And it's been really great to see over the last 12 years how it's changed to from me cold calling communities and really pushing and selling the benefits of skate parks to youth and the benefits to the community, to now I don't even really have to advertise that much. There's people phoning me, you know, our company's become really well known, and sales is one of the least things I even have to focus on anymore. I tend to go the extra mile for most of the projects that I do because I just love skate parks and I can't really help myself, but So in the Pemberton Skatepark, there are a few elements in it that are kind of floating and hanging and suspended. You'll see those. And those, again, required working with our engineers just to make sure they're not going to crack. I think it's the first park in the world, as far as I know, to use stone pool coping. So it's different and unique, and it's way more durable as well than concrete pool coping. Well, what created the passion to do what I do, obviously the main thing is that I'm a skateboarder. And it's not just that I'm a skateboarder, but I'm a skater that grew up skating all kinds of stuff. We grew up street skating, but I also grew up skating a lot of parks. So to be able to create whatever I want, almost, and to have people build it, it's still incredible to me to this day that I can go make this, you know, 12-foot deep bowl with a foot of vert on it, and it happens. You know, it's pretty amazing. As far as what I do in the office, my favorite part is definitely designing the parks. There's still a ton of business stuff to do and numbers to crunch and people to call and all that stuff. So really riding the parks is definitely the most fun aspect. I mean, that's what I love to do, is ride my skateboard. So to get to ride in these things that I've dreamed up, and to get to, you know what I really like is to get to show up to a park where I've planned out the lines to work in a certain way, like you'll hit this element and then that, and then get fit down here. And just to be able to drop in and hit that line first run and have it work is really, really fun and satisfying. Yeah, some of the things that suck. It really sucks when I work with a community for 5 years straight, you know, giving them my time and helping out, and it turns out that something happens and their community doesn't support the park. So there's the core group of people that want it. The larger community says, sorry, after all that work you guys put in, we're not even going to give you a park. Forget it. So through 12 years of doing this, I've learned a ton, and it's all in engineering, architecture, design. If I had been a landscape architect or an engineer or had any kind of training in those fields, even drafting design, I would have been miles ahead and wouldn't have been, you know, struggling and learning on the job for years, figuring it out as I went. I would say for anybody who wants to look into skate park design as a career, number one is obviously skateboard. You have to understand what it is that you're doing and have a deep understanding of how skateboarding works. Travel a lot, skate all different types of stuff, skate streets, go to travel all over the place and skate all the parks that are in your area, and pay attention to what works and what doesn't work and why things work the way they do. Doing this, if you do it right, you can make a good living. Absolutely. It's I guess I'm paid on par with architects and landscape architects, so it's a great living. I'm able to pay my mortgage and make a truck payment and save money on top of it, so it's working out fantastic.